Hi, assalamu alaikum and welcome to another
Walaikum
session.
salam.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. Welcome to another session of Pides War on COVID-19. Today we're in conversation with Dr. Rana Jawad Asgar. Dr. Rana Jawad Asgar is Chief Executive Officer of GHSI, Global Health Strategists and Implementers, a consulting firm in Pakistan. He's an adjunct professor of epidemiology at the University of Nebraska and a member of WHO roster of experts in epidemiology and surveillance. He was fourth Pakistani to be selected in 60 plus years, year history of Epidemic Intelligence Service, US CDC. He has served as program manager for Child Survival Program in Mozambique, faculty member at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine and Research Associate at the Stanford University. He set up Pakistan Field Epidemiology and Laboratory Training Program and Disease Surveillance and Response Units as US CDC resident advisor working with Government of Pakistan. Assalamu alaikum, sir. We're really honored to have you with us today.
So Walaikum salam.
To begin with, sabse pehle, we know that all of us have been getting our fair share of correct and wrong information about what the coronavirus is. So can we start with what do we know about the virus so far? How close are we to an end to this pandemic? So will it just die down naturally, or is our scientists working to develop a vaccine for it? So where is the world in response to the coronavirus so far?
Thank you very much. This is a coronavirus. It's very similar to another virus which came in 2000, I believe in 3 or 4, which is SARS coronavirus. So actually it is so similar that its technical name is SARS-CoV-2. So it's like the second version of that SARS virus. There is a lot has been known about this virus in last 3 months when it known to us that a new virus has emerged, but still many key, qualities are important information about this virus is not known. And scientists around the globe are trying to understand it better. A simple thing like what is, how many people it can kill, like a basic information, how many people it can infect, how many ways it can infect others. These are basic things which we are trying to learn very quickly about it. So, because it has devastated world economies across the globe, so everyone is working on it. There are so many scientists, scientific teams around the globe who are trying to understand and control it. All outbreaks or pandemics die on their own. But the question is, at what cost? If we let them die down, it may kill millions of people. Coronavirus has already killed more than close to 150,000 people and has sickened nearly 2 million people. So if we just let it die down, which always happen, it may be hundreds of millions of deaths. So that's why it's important to work on its control strategies. Until we have medicines or vaccines, we are coming up with non-pharmaceutical interventions, which includes this social distancing, lockdowns, hand hygiene, all those kind of things. It's very hopeful. I'm very hopeful that very soon we will have effective medicines, and again in a year time, and maybe an effective vaccine.
Thank you very much, sir. How far do you see this? As you said, non-pharmaceutical solutions that we have. How far do you see these going? How far do you see the lockdown going?
So the issue of lockdown, we have an example of China. But China was a big country, strong economy. So when it locked down one province of 60 million, it still had a big economy of a billion people supporting that 60 million people. So it managed it well. And it has a different way of governing people, where there is an absolute authority. Not many other countries have the same government structure, so that lockdown may not be applicable in rest of the world. That's what we have seen. So different countries are trying different versions of lockdowns. We are also doing it in Pakistan. But big countries like us, a poor country, it's difficult to sustain lockdown for a long term. And even the developed countries, including US, Spain, which has the biggest burden of deaths, has starting to open up because it's not sustainable in a long run, just having a lockdown.
Yes, sir. On the same note, on being, facing economic challenges, being a healthcare professional, how do you observe Pakistan's current preparedness for the coronavirus, including availability of professionals, beds, ventilators, other resources, probably isolation centers, and PPE for the doctors as well?
The thing is that health system preparedness is always a long-term planning and long-term investment. It cannot be ramped up in a few months. So we need to understand this. You need to invest over the years in your health system, its preventive care, and all those kind of things, which we have not done. So, in last 3 months, there has been race to ramp up our activities or our efforts, but it has a limitation. You cannot ramp up for that pandemic in 3 months. You can do some things which Pakistan has done, but it's far less than what is needed. What the Pakistan should learn out of it, once it come out of it, is to invest properly on health and consider it as critical as the national security. Because what we have seen, the countries with big armies and air force and arsenal have pretty much failed to protect their citizens from the death. And that's what the national security is all about.
On the same note, can you reflect a little on the incident that happened in Quetta where young doctors came out to actually protest about the unavailability of PPE and they were not treated with very professionally or nicely?
This is a shame, actually, around the globe, because this is a dangerous virus and we still can't figure it out completely with certainty that how it is spreading so fast. And the doctors, the medical care staff is giving the highest toll of any profession. If you can just look at the numbers, in Italy alone, more than 60 doctors died. I'm not counting nurses, paramedical staff. In Pakistan, two doctors have already died of coronavirus, and I believe some nurses have also died. So this is a group of people who is risking their life to protect the nation. So we need to give them the best available equipment we have. So I was actually dismayed to see high government officials and political leaders when they are touring their areas or different facilities. They are wearing N95 masks, which should just only be provided to our medical staffs who's taking care of COVID-19 patients. And that's the danger or disappointment, that our medical staff does not have access to enough N95, but why the senior government officials are wearing this? They should stay in their offices if they can't just wear a regular mask. They should wear the regular mask and tour if they want. But the N95 masks, which has a shortage around the globe, should be reserved only for medical care staff.
What other problems, other than the lack of protective gear and other resources, what other problems do you think the health sector has, and how can they be prevented? Do you see other problems that are not spoken about so far?
Yes. So let's, if we talk about the context of coronavirus or COVID-19, the infection control practices in our hospitals, clinics, across the board are far from satisfactory. I'm not even calling them good. They are far from satisfactory and actually maybe failing at most places. Even those the big names of hospitals you talk about, we don't have that level of infection control practices. And that's why we have just seen that around, 30 of the medical care staff, including, 26 doctors in Nishtar Medical College or hospital, got infected. That should be, you know, the government should stop there. And the health administration should stop there and say, what has went wrong that such a big number of doctors got infected? They should have been protected. So there must be a failure on a big scale which has happened, and someone has to look into it just to make sure that we don't repeat those things in other hospitals. Because if our healthcare system got infected the way it has got infected Nishtar, then you don't have going to have people who can then provide you treatment. So this is a critical and very dangerous sign.
So do you mean the failure is not only on a political level, but it is also there on the grassroots administrative level?
True. Because again, and because no one has paid attention to those things for decades. And so there is a complete lack of understanding, lack of education, and lack of emphasis on this. So there may be not enough resources for disinfectant. There may not be enough trainings for the doctors and healthcare staff to how they can protect themselves. There may be insufficient supply of PPE. So this could be anything, but it's a major failure.
So you recently wrote about the criminalization of the disease, and you also mentioned that if you continue the way we are continuing treating the patients, there will be a significant underreporting in the symptoms, because people will fear coming out about having the virus, and that might result in sudden surges. So can you elaborate Yes. a little more on that?
So one strategy people are trying to follow, which was China's strategy, is to isolate positive cases in quarantine centers. And our quarantine centers are not the places where people want to go because of the lack of facilities and lack of the cleanliness and the lack of, we have seen this in Taftan quarantine center and even other quarantine centers. And people are being forcefully evicted of their houses, the whole families, and put in somewhere else. It was a heartbreaking picture when I saw two young brother and sister in an ambulance who got positive, and they were separated from their family. This is, I'm sorry, this is idiotic. You don't control disease. I said this is idiotic. This is complete stupid. You need to deal with the cases with respect, understand their mental situation, understand their sensitivities. If people have seen this picture, there will be fewer people stepping up and says, okay, we think we have coronavirus, please test us. Because, separating families, separating young kids from their families, this is a big thing. And we have also seen that it came on a social media that there was few cases in a house in Lahore Model Town, and there was so many photographs and videos, including the name of the number of the house, the owner of the house, and complete list of the patients. And if you create this stigma, people will stop coming forward. And we have seen this in other diseases like this. We have seen this in Ebola in Africa, where people do not want to get tested. And because if they don't get tested, they don't know they have a virus, and then keep infecting the community, and outbreak become difficult to control. We have seen this in HIV outbreak, when we make it a stigma and as a disease of shame, then people stop coming forward. But that doesn't mean this disease will go away. The outbreak will become bigger and bigger, and eventually one day you will see a much bigger impact. So I think this is a wrong strategy. We should provide proper respect to the cases, and if they have enough space at house where they can be separated, the positive cases, they should be allowed. Only if they don't have enough space, then they should be moved to quarantine centers, but these with respect and dignity, and they should be provide all the facilities which are required.
As for quarantine centers, sir, do we have enough quarantine centers for that matter?
I think there has been some ramp up. We didn't have enough quarantine centers before, but I think now each province has created their own quarantine centers in different part of the cities. I'm not aware of how good or bad they are.
Sir, in terms of the panic that was around the disease, and you know, it's still there and going strong. I want some, you know, for you to break it up for us normal people. How much at risk is the average person to get the virus? What are the you know, major sources of threat? What places should people avoid? Because now that the lockdown has been slightly, you know, has been made softer, I can see movement outside my house as well. I can see people coming to the mosque. I can see a couple of kids coming to the park. And I have been told that some of the offices have, you know, been reopened as well. So what are the areas that you think are, you know, the most risky to go to? And how does a normal person avoid getting infected?
Yes. No, we are also normal people.
I understand that.
So I will tell you how I do my grocery shopping. I don't do it every single day. So basically, I make sure that I buy things enough for next 5 days or 6 days. Mm-hmm. So once you limit your going out, you are limiting your chances of infection. So instead of going every day, I'm limiting my chances of getting infected. Like instead of 100%, I'm decreasing it to 20% because I'm going every 5 days. So number one. Number two, I'm preferring now those shops which are small, which are open air. So like, you know, the sabzi wala, you know, the vegetable vendor, if he's on a ready open air shop. So I will go there. And normally people go to those shops which they normally go. So they know each other. So I just tell him, these are the things I want. Give him a list. And keep a distance of minimum 3 feet, but try to have, 5 or 6 feet. So instead of looking at each vegetable or pick every fruit with everybody, I keep a distance. So that's the number one thing. Then the grocery stores, now I'm not going to the big stores. And I'm again picking the small shops where I can, which are open door policy, because it's important there is a good ventilation wherever you go and there are fewer people. And if there are more people in the shop, I will wait outside. Once the shop has fewer people based on its space, then again I will do the same. I will tell them, because they know normally you buy groceries from one or two stores or shops. So I tell them, these are the things I want. They will pack it. So I normally stay sometimes at the door of the shop, or even step outside, and so minimize my contacts. But I go and buy the milk also, the fresh milk. Don't go there daily. Buy some fresh milk and some carton, you know, the packed milk. So these are the few things. But every time I come back to my car, I use hand sanitizer. And once I'm inside the house, the first thing I do is again wash my hands with soap for 20 minutes. And try not to touch my face or mouth with my hands when I'm outside, buying those things. Now people are wearing face masks also, regular cloth mask, which is okay. Because what we are learning is it has a asymptomatic, people are also spreading. So everyone, that will protect us as a community, because if that person is infected, there will be less chances for him to infect others. It may not protect us from getting the infection, but it will protect as a community to limit the transmission. So these are the few simple measures which I follow when I do the shopping. One thing, I also still get the newspaper. I still read the newspaper because people are worried. So what I do, once the hawker delivered the newspaper in the house, I had made a solution of Dettol and water. I spray it, up and down, and then let it in the sun for another hour. And today, you know, this is the summer, so normally there's a good heat outside. And this two things, sunlight and this Dettol spray. And after 1 hour or so, I read the newspaper. Again, the same precautions. After reading newspapers or handling the newspaper, I wash my hands for 20 seconds. So anything which is coming from outside and you're touching, just make sure that after handling it, you wash your hands.
So, sir, another last layperson question, and that is that when you take grocery inside your house, do you wash the packages? Because some people do that, including me.
I don't. We wash the vegetables and keep it. I have not done this, the cleaning the packages or something. Because normally they are not too much handled. Like if a packed stuff has come, there may be few people and it's a long travel. So chances of an infected person touching it in Pakistan at this time, I'm saying in Pakistan at this time, is still very low. If you are living in New York, where 150,000 cases and around 2,000 deaths, I may have a different threshold of precautions. Yes. But Pakistan has still not that many cases based on our population.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your time and for your insights and for clarifying some of our doubts. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It was lovely having you, and we'll stay in touch, inshallah, for further communication as well.